cancer, the big C. It is the word that frightens so many people. Even recently, my mother doesn't even know this. I had to go to the doctor for a skin testing. And they called me back and they said, it's not cancerous. I said, well, praise God. And she said, well, I thought you were gonna be more nervous. I said, no, because when you took the little skin test, I declared it's not cancer. And so I know many people have declared it's not cancer, but it was cancer. And so my testimony today is that God has kept the big C from me, but it's come against my brother, it's come against my sister, and they have victory. Over 1.6 million people every year are diagnosed with different forms of cancer. It's a disease, it's a diagnosis that kills hundreds and thousands and takes the lives, people with purpose, every year. And so we want to talk to you today and give you encouragement, victory stories about people who have overcome the scare of cancer. Anybody in here ever been scared by the word? Every time as women we go and do our annual exam, they can come back with something. And so we want to make sure that there are testimonies that you're hearing of women who have found victory. We have three dynamic women that are going to share their stories. And I wanted today to focus on millennials. Young women under the age of 25 who have been diagnosed with different forms of cancer, and they will tell you their stories. Then we have one mother here. We have one mother here who's telling the story of her beautiful daughter whose victory was found on the other side of cancer. And she will tell you her story of raising her grandson and moving forward in life. I need for you to stay with us and stay tuned as you are encouraged that even with a diagnosis of cancer, you can live life, come out of chemo in the same week and find yourself in New Orleans. You'll hear that story in just a second.
Get your body back with Body by Creighton. Champion bodybuilder Andre Creighton will work you into the best shape of your life. Call 701-3094 for a free consultation.
We are being joined now by Rachel Bruno, who will tell us her story, her intimate story about being diagnosed with cancer. Three times or
twice? Twice.
Twice. We'll be right back. Outstanding. Thank you. Thank you for being with us, Rachel.
Thank you for inviting me.
Absolutely. We want to hear your story. We want to hear your story. And what I really want you to start with is tell us, what were you doing before this diagnosis came upon you?
Just the average working person. I had a job working in a medical billing field for quite a long time, probably about 5-6 years at that time. And I had a part-time job working at a country club. So I was just running back and forth between jobs, just normal person.
Okay. And you were how old at that time?
26.
26. So you're a little over 25, but still that millennial who we often don't think about as being diagnosed with cancer. We often look at women my age or in their 30s, 40s, 50s, but we don't often think about the 20-some-year-old.
No.
And so you're living life, you're having fun. Do you have children yet?
No, no children.
Okay. Were you dating at the time?
No.
Okay. So then you found yourself, what happened? You just weren't feeling well. What happened?
I had a bad case of heartburn. And I'd gone to the doctor, and I started with home remedies from a teaspoon of mustard to baking soda. And
where you get that?
Someone at work suggested it.
Okay. So, mustard for heartburn. I hadn't heard it, but okay.
That was a new one. I said, well, maybe something new. But I'd gone to the doctor, and he said, well, maybe your reflux medication, because I was on something for acid reflux. He said, maybe it's decided to stop working, and we need to try something else. Gave me a different prescription. And instinctually, I just knew something's not right, and that's not enough. So I, instead of going to work, I went to the ER and I said, I'm having chest pain and something's not right. And when you mentioned that going to the ER, they immediately think heart trouble. Mm-hmm. So they start an immediate workup. And after a few hours, they said, well, your blood doesn't look right. We're going to run some more tests. X-rays, scans came back, and the doctor said, well, we see a large amount of fluid around your heart, as well as what we believe is a lymphoma. So we're going to admit you and begin more testing. So after about 2 days of testings, pokings, and proddings, they said it was Hodgkin's lymphoma, stage 2. And the doctor said, I don't care where it came from. We know it's here. We're going to get rid of it. And you start your treatment today.
Now, let me ask you a question. So from the time of, how long were you dealing with the heartburn before you went to the doctor?
I think that was maybe 3-4 months. Wow. And they say, because I'm also asthmatic, they say that can be a part of being an asthmatic.
So you counted those things to other, the yes. reflux or the asthma issues. Okay.
Exactly.
And we do that.
Yeah.
We do that. We're constantly have a headache, but we just say, oh, it's stress or it's something else. When really should go get it checked and keep digging until we get the answer that we need. So your doctor that day started you on chemo.
Yep, I started my first chemo while I was still in the hospital and spent the weekend there because, of course, I was sick from all of the medication and everything and the treatment. And from then I did 12 chemo treatments twice a month. And then I did a month of radiation, which put me back in the hospital because the radiation was along my neck and chest to where it's called this severe dysphagia, where I'm not even able to swallow my own saliva.
Wow.
So I wasn't able to swallow saliva, food, drinks, anything. Spent about a month in the hospital behind that.
Okay. So what was support like for you in these months? Or was it months or years?
Months. Okay. I was diagnosed in March of 2008 and spent that entire summer and fall with treatment and was able to go back in January. I had plenty of support. I had relatives across the country calling and sending messages and flowers. My coworkers gathered and sent a beautiful ceramic angel, and they even were nice enough to send a money donation. So that was definitely helpful, not working and being 26 and healthy and not thinking about needing anything extra. I didn't have insurance, the disability insurance.
Okay.
So I wasn't working.
To pay you while you were off.
Exactly. So not working, I had no money. So thankfully, I had plenty of family, relatives, and even my parents to help make sure that I was still able to continue to keep my apartment, my car, and everything while I got through
that's
that.
That's a blessing.
Oh, yes.
Blessing.
I'm forever thankful.
So you had this diagnosis, and you went, so it was several months, and then you went several months of treatment. And then you were diagnosed with remission.
Yes, they said.
And how long was your remission?
My remission was actually quick. I started treatment in March, and come May, June-ish, they said, oh, your tumor's gone. You're considered in remission. But we're going to continue treatment because if we don't, you're going to be right back here doing this all over again in 6 months or a year.
Okay.
So I was.
Why did they say that? Do you know why they said that?
Because you have to treat it as if you have an infection where you take an antibiotic. If you don't
finish it.
If you don't finish the antibiotic, you run a greater risk of that infection returning very quickly. And sometimes when it returns, it's much more aggressive. And he said, we don't want that to happen. We want you to get rid of this and go on with life.
Excellent. So then you went on with life.
Yes.
And something happened again.
Well, I was good for, 7.5 years or so, I guess. Time flies when you're getting back to normal.
Yeah, uh-huh.
I mean, I went back to work, bought a condo, went and just, started to get back to a new normal. And then all of a sudden, I noticed a lump to pop up, and I said, okay, that's not normal. And it's new, but it did a disappearing act. It would swell and shrink and swell and shrink for a few months. Finally, I called my doctor's nurse, and I said, I left a message. I said, I have a lump here that's not normal, and I'm pretty sure he wants to see it. And I went in, and after some testing and 3 months of waiting for results, they determined that it was a spindle cell sarcoma, which is radiation-induced. So the radiation treatment I had for the first cancer caused the second one.
Okay.
So that...
Did you guys know things like that happen?
No.
Yeah, right. See, they don't tell you these things. They tell you, it's like in the fine print of a contract. No one ever reads it. They just sign on a dotted line. Yeah, that's kind of how that goes. Something like that is, you know, bound to happen. So I began treatment. And I started off with radiation to shrink it. And once they shrunk it, let it, you know, really shrink down small enough, they did a surgery to remove it. Mm-hmm. And the doctor said, well, we got about 98% clean margins. We're going to give you a couple of doses of chemo just to be safe. Mm-hmm. And then you should be good to go. So I did chemo for about 4 months. And from then, I've been still in recovery, dealing with the side effects of the surgery.
What have been some of the side effects?
Besides the hair loss and nausea, fatigue, I've dealt
being
with
cold or hot
temperature changes. Yeah. That's still one thing I'm dealing with here, and it's been about a year and a half out of treatment, and I'm still dealing with temperature changes. So I feel like I'm, you know, freezing cold 1 minute, and then 2 minutes later I feel like I'm sweating and I have to start snatching clothes off.
All right, David, and you're not praising.
Yes, but I mean, you just don't know what side effects you'll end up with. Like, I'm dealing with a neuropathy issue, and after the tumor removal, I have some nerve damage in my arm, which is definitely affecting me because I've not yet been able to go back to work because of the nerve damage, because it reaches down and into my hand. So it's just so many different things. You just never know.
But ever since I met you, and I met you through your sister, Alicia.
Yes.
And because she's a beast of a cake maker,
oh,
right?
Yeah.
And she really is. Alicia Bruno. So find her on Facebook.
Alicia Bruno Murray.
Find her on Facebook. So I met you through her.
Yes.
And really, I came in contact with you because of an issue that you had at Latitude 360.
Yes, Latitude
and that's how. And I was outraged. When injustice happens, I just get something happens in me. Can you tell us that story?
I had finished chemo April 1st of last year, 2015. And normally I'm kind of out of it because of the medication to keep the nausea at bay. But I was feeling halfway decent, yet still tired and weak. And my sister decided, the girls wanted to go to Latitude to hang out with their friends, mm-hmm. just kind of play. I said, okay, I'll get out of the house, go ride, just to, you know, nice, get out of the house and just kind of enjoy a little fresh air, a different scenery, instead of laying around in the couch all day.
Mm-hmm.
And I was told that I could not enter the establishment because of the beanie, crocheted beanie that I had on my head. And once I explained that I'm a cancer patient and have no hair and I needed that cap to keep my head warm, they said, no, I'm sorry, it's company policy. We need you to remove it or you're going to have to leave. So instead of arguing, and I was already tired and frustrated, I just left and went to the car. I explained it to my sister and went and sat in the car. And from then, it's just been, it's been a mess. They did apologize, but mm-hmm. and I was able to meet with the CEO of the company later that month. But it never did turn out to be anything. I mean, they couldn't change. They said they couldn't change policies because everything that they had written was, according to their lawyers, correct to not offend anyone. Mm-hmm, although mm-hmm. their policy did say no backwards caps, no do-rags, no skull caps, no slouching or baggy clothes, which to me kind of errs towards one
a
specific
particular group.
Yes.
Well, we know that. I did reach out to them, I had not heard back from them because they were going to do an event for you and things
yes.
like that. And so they have transitioned from Indianapolis, so that's one of the reasons why I do feel comfortable with you sharing, because you tried to reach out, I tried to reach out. But it's just, to me, the injustice was you were not well, this was necessary.
Yes.
But the grace of it, the blessing of it, is that I was allowed to meet you and
yes.
come into your contact. And the reason I wanted you to share that story was because since I've met you, you've had the most positive attitude, beautiful spirit through it all. And so I just want to applaud you with that.
Thank you.
When we come back, we will bring to you our next guest who will share their story. Her name is Chastity Bale. And you want to hear about Chastity Bale, honey. She's a whole nother level of faith. And so we thank you. We
thank you.
We thank you. We thank you.
Thank
and we
you.
Speak your healing. And we declare that God's healing will be over your life. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
grace. What is the purpose of grace? Grace is God giving us what we do not deserve, and mercy is God withholding from us what we do deserve. Often we only look at grace as being what is given to us unto salvation, the grace that we were given to save us. But I want to tell you today, Titus 2 reminds us that grace also gives us the power to live right, the power to walk out a life that is godly and pleasing to the Lord, to say no to the things that we struggle with. I want to encourage you today to tap in to grace. Go beyond the grace of your salvation and know that it is God's grace that leads us to a holy life. Thank you all so much for joining us and coming back with us. Right now, we are going to hear from Chastity Bell. She's been a mentoree of mine for a mentee. That's what I've learned last night, a mentee, since the sixth grade. And this young lady is dynamic. I'm so proud of her. I tell her she's my other hero. We'll be right back. Chastity Bell. Chastity, girl. This is awesome. Look at you. I can call you girl now. You're a grown lady. You're a woman.
Well, thank you.
Remember, what did Miss Tate used to tell y'all? Y'all had to call me Miss Tate?
We had to always call you Miss Tate.
Until you were 80.
And I have not stopped. I'm 27. I still call you Miss Tate.
You do. She actually interned for me, and she still was calling me Miss Tate then. So that was funny because everyone else was calling me Tuesday, I think.
They were.
So they were. You had to help them out. So, Chastity Bell,
yes.
You are a 28-year-old, dynamic, progressive, thriving, striving, young African-American woman.
Yes, ma'am.
So you, where did you attend?
Kentucky State University.
Yes, she did.
Yes.
And so let's talk about where we met, how we met.
Oh, Lord. sixth grade at Howe Academy. Mm-hmm. I was hanging out with some of my friends that have different lifestyles now than I do, but I was challenging myself. Mm-hmm. I don't want to say that I was a bad kid. I wasn't bad. I was just learning myself. Mm-hmm. And they referred me to your mentoring program. It was probably the best thing that had happened to me at that time. And we literally connected from sixth grade until now.
Until now.
So.
Yes.
Yes, definitely took.
Now, did you go on those trips with me?
Like, I did.
Okay.
To Kentucky State.
And all of that. That's yes. Okay. So we did college tours and things like that. Yes. And the camping. And
yes.
Bless her heart. She's just, I love Chastity. I love Chastity, y'all. So, Chastity, you went off to college.
I did.
And you were very involved as an undergraduate student at Kentucky State. And so what all were you involved in as an undergrad?
I was a student ambassador, which we give tours to prospective students who want to attend Kentucky State University. I ran for Miss KSU. I was second attendant to Miss KSU 2011. What else did I do? I did mentoring with some of the freshmen, girls, very active with the Disability Resource Center. I worked, that was my part-time job for work study.
So you were busy.
I was
busy.
I was a partier too.
Okay.
Let's not leave that out.
Black college partier. Yes. It almost goes hand in hand.
It does.
So tell us, one day something happened.
Yes. So it was after homecoming week, and I thought I just partied too hard, and I just could not get out of bed. I was tired. My body was hurting. I wasn't eating. I wasn't drinking, and something was wrong. And so my roommate at the time was like, Jesse, this is not like you. I think you should go to the doctor.
Well, and you were how old?
I was 22.
Okay.
And so it's Frankfurt. Frankfurt's small. You really don't have many places to go. So the only place I knew to go was the ER. So I went to the ER. They did several tests. I went when the sun came up, and I did not leave till the sun went down. And after several hours of testing, the doctor came back. He said the x-ray showed an overgrown cyst that was connected to my ovary. And he was saying that was what was causing all the pain. And so he said he will refer me to an OBGYN that next day, and that they would give me medicine to shrink it. And something in me said, nah, I need to go home and get a second opinion. At the time, my younger sister was pregnant, so she got me in connection with her OBGYN. And she told me to come in as soon as possible. So I hurried to Indianapolis because I was in Frankfurt. And that next morning, well, probably, I think it was a Monday morning, can't remember the dates, but got in and she did several ultrasounds. So she did an intro ultrasound and then she did an outer ultrasound. And through the ultrasound, she knew in that moment that it was cancer. She was like, worst case scenario, it's cancer. I've never had cancer, any case of cancer in my family before. Okay. So that was a shocker for me. And
at 22.
At 22. So I'm just like, oh, okay. Tell me what I need to do so I can get back to school. It was my senior year. It was going into my senior year. And she was like, well, I don't think you're going to be going back anytime soon. So she was like, I think we need to prep you for surgery. And by the time I left her office, I was in connection with a surgeon. He gave me instructions to prepare for surgery that later on that week. By Wednesday, I was taking the oral drink to prepare for surgery. Thursday, Friday, I was in surgery.
Wow. Yeah. Now, that's pretty progressive, similar to Rachel's story, that your doctors got right on it.
Yes.
And I'm hoping that's typical.
Yes, I believe it's typical.
I pray it is. Pray it is. Now you said you weren't feeling well. You thought you had partied too much. How long before the thought I partied too much before you took yourself to ER?
Oh, that was maybe 2 days.
Okay.
So maybe a day in the bed, and then the next day I spoke with like the nurse at the Betty White services on campus, and she was like,
so one of the things I'm hearing that both of you ladies have said is it's important to know your own body.
Yes.
Yeah, to know your own body, that something's not right. This is not, and then to, because sometimes, particularly as women, we'll just keep pressing ourselves, going on, got to get this done, need to get this done. And it's good to have good friends to say, no, you need to take your chocolate cell, vanilla cell, caramel cell, vanilla would be our Caucasian sisters, amen, pink self, whatever,
right,
to the doctor, to the hospital. You need to go. Don't waste, don't mess around with this.
Mm-mm.
Yes.
Because it's serious.
It's serious. It's serious. So when you heard that word cancer, and I did not, I forgot to ask Sister Rachel this, but maybe when we all come back together, she can answer this question. What was that like hearing?
Honestly, I didn't believe it. Because I had never had any case of cancer in my family. So when she said it, it shocked me, but I didn't believe it was going to be true.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and at that moment, my faith wasn't as strong. So I was just like, whatever. I'm just going to go to the doctor. I'll prep for surgery. Coming out of surgery is when my faith kicked in for the first time.
It got real.
It got real, real.
It got real. That's tweet. It got real. So listen, this is the thing. I think some of it is the, and I don't mean this word in a negative way, ignorance means to ignore the truth.
Oh, yes.
And some of the millennial, the 20-something, is the ignorance of sometimes the seriousness of it maybe just allowed you to not trip.
Right.
Right.
I definitely agree.
Yeah. And so that was your safeguard.
Yes.
And so we give God glory for all things. So you had the surgery. You said you came out and it got real.
Yes. So I woke up in recovery. We knew going in, like, the ultimate goal was to get the tumor out. And at the time, we just knew that it was something. They called it a mass at the time. So they were like, we need to get the mass out. When we get it out, we'll test it. We'll know if it's cancer or not. My family knew, of course, while I was in recovery. I wake up. I see all of my family surround my bed. And I'm just thinking, oh, it's great. They're all here, you know. The first thing I remember saying, was it cancer? And my grandmother said, yes, it was. And I just remember sobbing. I cried. And I literally cried myself back to sleep. Or they gave me a sedative, one or the other. But I believe I cried myself to sleep. And then I woke up again, and my family was still there. And then I cried, but it wasn't tears of fear. Out of fear, it was more, I'm happy that I have my family here to hold me and support me. And so we talked and we laughed. And when I say, you were there too. When I say it was a ton of people, I thought it was a party at the hospital. I mean, it was a ton of people there. And so then they knew right away that I would have to do chemotherapy. So as soon as I got out of the hospital, I started chemo.
Excellent. So how long was remission?
Remission was about a year and a half. And then I went, because after I finished chemo, because I was going into my senior year, I had to go back and finish, and I finished school, thank God, graduated with my bachelor's, and then maybe that summer, going into the fall, I found out again that I came out of remission.
Is that when you were working for me?
I was working for you, yes.
Or with whatever,
I finished the internship, went back to school, and we found out that the cancer was back, and it was a recurrence of the ovarian cancer. That was the first cancer that I was diagnosed with, which is not a not normal for a 22-year-old African-American woman. That was just a rare case. And for it to be
so it wasn't HPV, it wasn't any of that.
It was ovarian cancer, which is very strange. And they did testing for, like, genetics and different things, and none of it, everything was negative. It wasn't positive. So we have no solution on how I got it.
Okay.
So it didn't come from my genes. And the only way they would have known that the cancer was in my uterus is the second time we found out through a scan, just the normal checkup that I have to do and any cancer patient mm-hmm. or survivor has to do. They found it in the uterus, and I was there all along. I think that's where it started, and it kind of ventured out to the ovary. So I had a partial hysterectomy the first time.
How old were you?
22, partial. And then the second time I was going into my 24th birthday, and I had a full hysterectomy.
Now, I'm going to tell you, that made me mad.
I know you did.
That made me mad.
I know it made you mad.
Yeah, 24, I'm like the devil, and yeah. I went all the way in.
Yeah,
I did. But when I got to the hospital, your spirits was, and I'm like, what you beating up the devil for? Because she okay,
yeah,
you know?
That's good.
And so she's, I'm telling you, her faith, she really, just watching her from a distance. Sometimes I would call you and mm-hmm. I'd be like, can we do lunch? Can I? And she's like, oh, I got this. I'm like, girl, make time for me. Make time for me. So, you know, one of the things and it was really through your diagnosis, I really started studying what it meant for remission.
Mm-hmm.
When doctors would say you're in remission, they cannot say that you're healed.
Right.
They can't say that. But what God showed me was the only remission is for sin.
Mm-hmm.
And he took everything.
Right.
He took sickness. He took disease. And so even when, and I understand you have to go by what the doctors are saying. I absolutely understand that. But what I want to encourage us, if you are faith people, put God's word on it. Now, the doctors say I'm in remission, but you say I'm healed, because there is no remission except that for sin,
right.
Which means he forgave it all.
Right.
He's forgive. Your sicknesses are under the blood. Your diagnoses are under the blood. Everything that comes that is not of God is under the blood, and it's under the blood of Jesus Christ. And Jesus is our healer.
Amen.
And so that should have got a clap from somebody. So then you go through this victory. And what happened?
Go back to work and go through checkups like normal another year and a half in, and then boom, we found it again in the scan. This time it wasn't a reoccurrence of the ovarian cancer, which we thought it was, not even a lump. It was just in the scan and it just looked different. It was in my neck area, and the doctor was like, he thinks it's a lymphoma. And to me, I'm like, oh my Jesus, what is a lymphoma? Like,
mm-hmm.
tell me what it is. It was Hodgkin's lymphoma.
Now tell us what that is.
Hodgkin's lymphoma is it's a cancer in the lymphatic system, so like the lymph nodes in your body that are throughout your body, and they're just like receptors. They tell your body like you're sick.
Mm-hmm.
That's how you find out. That's why your glands swell and stuff in your neck. And so randomly I had that in my body, and I can't remember the stage, and this was the most recent one. This was last fall when I found out, in October of last year. Went through, I can't even remember how many sessions of chemo, but it was like every 2 weeks I was in chemo. And
this is why we're laughing, because this is the New Orleans story.
This is the New Orleans story, yeah. I finished chemo in July, and me and my roommate, we were planning a trip, and we're like, look, we're going to Texas. Like, we're going to Texas. We're going to Louisiana. Let's do it. Literally finished chemo 1 week. The next week, I was packing my bag, and I was in Texas, Houston, Texas, picking up her twin sister, and we drove to Louisiana. And
I'm on Facebook, I'm saying, she just got out. What is she doing?
Yeah.
And the pictures and everything.
I
so,
had a great time.
Yes, you did. And you are living life.
Oh,
you are
yeah.
continuing to live life. And I really applaud you for that. I applaud Rachel for that. And all women and men. But since we're talking to women, and Tuesdays with Tuesday, a Dr. Tuesday special is about empowering females and women. I applaud women who keep it moving.
Yes.
With all of our challenges and struggles, and it is encouraging. It has been encouraging to watch you, your pictures,
you.
When you didn't have any hair and your
oh, yeah.
face was slamming and jamming. And so just always, always being an encouragement and a light. And I bless God for you.
Thank you.
And I know you say you bless God for me, but
awesome.
I bless God for you.
Thank
I bless
you.
God for
I
you.
Love
Thank you.
You
so much for being with us. Let's give it up for Chastity Bell. Woo! Our hero. Thank you.
At barbecue heaven, get that barbecue bite. Come to barbecue heaven for your special appetite.
Get delicious barbecue ribs, hot chicken, baked beans, sweet potato pie, mac and cheese, corn on the cob, and so much more. Home of the famous barbecue on bun. Mm-hmm. Always warm and courteous service. Open 7 days a week. Located at 2515 MLK Junior Street and 877 East 30th Street, Indy.
Your barbecue play.
Story from a wonderful mother about a wonderful daughter. Her victory and her survival, we still say she's a survivor, happened on the other side of glory. And we will hear from Jorinda Henry about her daughter. Lord. Thank you all so much for joining us and coming back with us. We are talking this segment with Jorinda Henry, telling a wonderful story from a wonderful mother about a wonderful baby daughter, her only daughter, LaWanda. And let's hear from Sister Henry. Thank you so much for joining us. I appreciate this.
Thank you,
I really
Dr.
do.
Tuesday.
I really do.
Thank you.
So I met you at church,
yes,
and your daughter at church years ago. And I heard of LaWanda's battle. Several of us were serving in teen ministry, mm-hmm, and I heard of her battle at that time. And even me at that time thinking, gosh, that's too young. And she was diagnosed with breast cancer.
Yes.
And for us to know that 1 in 12 women are diagnosed with breast cancer every year. So in this room, we had about 30 women. And so in this audience of 30 plus women, knowing that at least 2 women in this room would be, if they have not already been diagnosed with breast cancer. Annually, there's about 240 some thousand women diagnosed with breast cancer. And so it is a concern. And as we opened this show, we talked about the big C and how it scares people. And we've learned from Rachel and Chastity that it's not just breast cancer, but cancer can affect women in many different ways. So this often seems to be the common one that women get the diagnosis about. So let's hear about your beautiful daughter.
Yes.
Who was LaWanda?
That was my only child, LaWanda Renee Henry. And at the time, she was 25 years old, and she called me. Actually, she discovered it herself. She had been going to the gym and working out. And she said, Mom, something is wrong. And I said, what do you mean? She said, I feel a lump. I'm hurting my shoulders. And I said, maybe you need to go to the doctor, just have it checked out, see what's going on. And she went in, and then that's when they discovered. The diagnosis came back, breast cancer. And we were very shocked, because for that age, but one of the things, she was in graduate school and very active, but had a son, was 2 years old. And I said, how could this be? I mean, life was going great. But we accepted it, and from there, it was a 3-year battle.
3 years, 3-year
yes.
battle. And I want to touch on that word you said, accepted it. It's your word, so I want to honor your word. But do we really accept it, or do we just say, okay, God?
Well, we knew that it was in his plan.
Okay.
It was a plan.
He was allowing it.
It was being allowed, and not only for her, but it also ended up being a great testimony to many other young people,
yes,
because we had never experienced having a family member nor a friend at that age to be diagnosed with cancer. Mm-hmm. And breast cancer, and of course, we knew about the walks and all of that, but at that time had not become involved. So after the diagnosis, and she was living in Atlanta at the time. And
I didn't realize she was in Atlanta at the time.
She was in Atlanta.
At Emory?
At Emory.
That's right.
She was going to graduate school at Emory.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so she came home.
Yes.
She came yes. home and treatments began.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
What was that like as a mommy?
It was hard, but I had a great support system. My family was right there. Friends and my church family was there. And her sorority was there. Mm-hmm. I can't speak enough for them, Deltas. Her sorority sisters were just right there to help us along the journey. And as I said, it was a journey because she went into remission 3 times. Mm. Lost the hair returned, beautiful. Mm-hmm. But the struggle was awesome because I had the young one to maintain, her son.
What's Khalid?
Khalid. Yes.
How is Khalid now?
Khalid is 22.
22 was 5 years. So this was 17 years ago.
Yes.
That's awesome.
Yes.
Yes. Now, Sister LaWanda, I remember her being maybe the word is no nonsense, but she seemed to like have fun. Like yes. she enjoyed life. How would you say this diagnosis affected her?
In a number of ways. For one of the things, she wanted to more or less be somewhat of an ambassador, letting other young women know the importance of their health and being tested. However, we know that, you know, at 25 and 27 or whatever, there are no mammograms or whatever, but however, taking care of their bodies and being able to go ahead if something is going wrong. And like the other young lady said, you should know your body, because if something is not right, mm-hmm. then don't put off going to the doctor.
Go to the
doctor and find out what it is.
Now, you know, as we were talking a couple of weeks ago, the letters.
Yes.
Your daughter wrote letters to everyone, mm-hmm. hand wrote letters and mailed them.
People.
Tell us about the letters.
Well, that was a way of communication, and also I felt it was therapy for her. At that time, there was no Facebook. I think it was MySpace or whatever, but it wasn't as popular as it is today. Mm-hmm. So therefore, the communication and with telephone. But that was her form of way of releasing, but also witnessing and letting her faith and the communication that she had with her family and friends was by writing the letters and sharing with them her progress. Mm-hmm. You know, rather than always, because there were many times she didn't feel, of course, like talking. And I would take I became the mom, the secretary, everything, whatever was needed. I had to be there for that. And but it also just drew us even closer together,
yes.
not knowing that the time was going to be short.
Yeah, 28 years, that's short.
That is.
So how did your faith as a mother play into you in the transition of your daughter and then raising your grandson as your son?
Mm-hmm. There is nothing like losing your child. And unless an individual has experienced it, to say, I understand, and yes, the support that was given to me was just unbelievable. But to be able to say, your child has gone on to glory, and that's exactly the way she was a very strong, her faith was very strong. Mm-hmm. And I know that she's looking down and smiling down on us right now. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And as you said, you were able to have the one-on-one with her in the youth ministry at our church. I had to accept the fact and go on with life, because I had to be strong for Khalid.
Yes.
And explaining to him what has taken place in his life with his mom.
Yes. I want to ask you a question. Was there a time that you were mad at God? Or like, my daughter, she's 28, Lord. Because I think sometimes as Christians, You know, we forget Jesus asked God questions in the garden. Lord, why have you forsaken me? Now, we could say, well, he wasn't mad, but he was like, God, where you at? You know, why have you forsaken me? Why have you left me? Why am I not on your mind? Why is this happening to me? Did you go through that as a mommy?
Not mad.
Okay.
I think at one point I did question, why is all of this taking place?
Mm-hmm.
But then I had to get down on my knees and pray, as I have always done.
Mm-hmm.
And that was where my release and my acceptance came in. The faith, it helped build my faith and let me know that, you know, this is not the end. And the beautiful part is that she knew the Lord.
Yes.
And that everything is okay.
And it's not the end, because you know, as a believer, you'll be there again.
As a believer. And yes. That was one of the things that our last conversation that we had, and those that came in contact with us knew, she loved banana pudding. And that was the last thing that she had that Wednesday afternoon.
Wow.
And the health nurse came in and told me, you should call your family, because the vital signs are leaving.
Mm-hmm. And you have banana pudding. That's a great memory.
Yes.
I know that might seem small to someone else.
Yes.
But to have those memories, mm-hmm, that you can hold on to.
And she asked me, she said, Mom, are they going to have banana pudding in heaven? I said, yes, but it's going to be better than this.
Better than this. That's than good. This. That is good. Yes. It's going to be better than this.
It's going to be better
that
than
is
this.
Awesome. That is awesome. So what I'm hearing consistently from all of you guys today, you wonderful ladies, is that faith is key. You know, acceptance is one of the five pillars of grief. The grieving process. And I can't remember if it's second or third, but you have to accept. And it sounds like when we have this personal relationship with Jesus Christ, we can get to acceptance quicker.
Mm-hmm.
We yes. may not like it, but we can get to acceptance quicker.
Yes.
And because God is still on the throne, and he knows why he allows things mm-hmm. to happen. We do not know. But one thing I remember, one of my first messages I preached at Eastern Star was titled, either God did it or God allowed it. But either way, he's in control.
Yes.
Because everything he doesn't do, it's not. We're saying God didn't do that, but he allowed it. But if he allowed it or he did it, he is in control.
Yes.
And we can have comfort in knowing that.
Yes.
We can have comfort in knowing that. I thank you. I thank you for sharing the story about your baby. I thank you. She was a beautiful young woman.
Thank you.
Beautiful son. Awesome young man that you have raised. You have raised and stepped in. And we thank God. Can we just clap for mommies? All the mommies in the audience. All the mommies. Hallelujah. That are watching. And so I thank God for you. I thank God for you.
I thank you.
I bless God. Thank you for being with us. Thank you, and we'll be back as we bring all four ladies together to answer one common question. What advice would you give someone who has been diagnosed with cancer? What would you tell their family how to be a support? We'll be right back.
Are you or someone you know suffering from addiction or depression? Call Emerald Neuro Recover now for their breakthrough NAD treatment that eliminates cravings and minimizes withdrawals. Questions? Call Amora now, 771-3721.
We are back with our three wonderful guests. I keep saying four, maybe I'm the fourth guest. So we are back with you wonderful ladies, Chastity, Rachel, and Miss Henry, and you have shared your stories of a daughter's victory, your victory, and your personal victories, ladies in the middle. So this is the question I would like for each of you to answer. What would you tell family members and friends how to support? It's a two-part question. How to support, and then how to stand. How to stand if you find this has happened to you as a 20-something, or you as a mom of a 20-something. So first, let's talk about how to have our family support. How should family support and come alongside?
Great.
sorry. All right. I believe just be there for them in any aspect that you can. If you can't be there physically, then send words of encouragement, or just simply just, hey, I was just thinking of you. I love those text messages.
You said something when we talked once. You said you had to accept that everybody's not going to be there.
Right.
Tell me about that.
Because some family members or friends can't be there because they don't know to be there, or in some ways, like you have spoken on, you're not a hospital person. I don't want to be in the hospital. I want to see you in that predicament. Let me see you in the element that I know that I want to see you in. So you have to accept them for them and know that they love you, but they love you from a distance because this is not a situation they want to see you in.
And maybe they can't handle it.
And they can't handle it.
Yeah, they can't handle it. Yeah. And so let's go ahead and answer the second question. If someone, a young woman, finds herself where you were, how would you encourage them?
Live. Have fun and live. If you have the energy, go out and party. No, just
But live.
But live. But no, live. Seriously, live. Yeah. If you want to get up and go bowling, go bowling. If you feel up to going out and having fun with your friends, go out and have fun with your friends. Mm-hmm. But live.
But live. But live. That's great. That's great.
I really don't know how to answer that question. I would say for family members, take your lead from the person that's going through it. Find out what it is that they need, and you know, follow their lead as far as support. If you see that they're lacking and they may need groceries, then pick up a few things and surprise them. I always love the surprises. I got several supplies. I had a cousin call and tell me, you know, what's your account number? I'm going to pay your phone bill for the next 6 months.
Awesome.
So that was the biggest blessing, because that was one thing I didn't want to lose was phone and internet, because mm-hmm. I'm like, I'm in the house. I need internet. I need to do something besides stare at a wall. But I also had family members that would at least send an email or a text message or something just to say, you know, just want to say hi. I don't know if you're feeling good or not. And I just want to check on you. And at the time that I was first diagnosed, the first time my mom was living with me, pretty much throughout the entire time. Mm. And she answered the phone, so I didn't have to. So I didn't have to feel like I was bombarded with a ton of phone calls. And the one time I did answer the phone, I got yelled at for answering my phone because I was supposed to be resting.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, I was glad that I had her support there. So she was there to just say, well, whatever you need, let me know, and I'll take care of it, or I see that you're out of this, or I see that, you know, this needs to be taken care of, I'll do it. So if the family could just do that, that's the biggest support
take
right there.
Take the lead from the person who's going through.
Yeah, that's definitely the best support, because going through, you don't know what you're going to encounter, you don't know what side effects you may or may not have, so everything is all new and confusing and scary. So if they're following you, that kind of comforts you a little bit. You don't feel like they're pushing you to go one direction or another.
What advice would you give that young woman who is diagnosed in her 20s?
Same thing Chastity said, live. I did try to do more things, but I was also very sick, so I wasn't able to. But now that I'm in the remission the second time, I'm getting out there. I'm doing more stuff, or at least I'm attempting to. I've been on a couple of trips, and I've got a couple more planned, so I can just get out and do more things, especially before I'm able to get back to work. And even once I get back, I'm planning more stuff. I've got my passport.
Awesome.
I'm planning on getting out of here. Yes. You definitely want to live. You definitely want to do as much as you can, but also make sure to connect with other people going through the same thing. Because your family and friends don't understand what you're dealing with, side effects, or the different things that kind of run through your mind, a little bit of depression that you may encounter. So you definitely want to connect with others. I connected with a lot of people through Facebook groups,
mm-hmm.
a lot of other parents and other survivors going through the same thing. So tips and tricks they were able to give me as far as managing the medications and things. And they understood when I say I'm frustrated with, you know, doctors taking too long to respond and different things. So they understand.
So you would advocate support groups even
definitely.
If you find them on Facebook?
Definitely. I'm not the type of person to go to a, say, in-person or roundtable support group, but the Facebook online groups and a lot of others that I belong to help. Just because I was able to talk with other mm-hmm. people, may not be face-to-face, but we would chat about understanding each other and
that's
what
good.
We're each going through.
That's good. That's good. That's good. Thank mm-hmm. you. Thank you. Thank you. And Ms. Henry.
Yes. Accept the support.
Yeah.
when you're offered, if someone say, I'll take, do this, be there for you, accept it. But also just try to be very, very positive, especially when you're going in, if someone is having treatments or whatever, let them know that you're there for them, regardless of how they're feeling, because their attitude and their acceptance of you may not be the way that it's always been, but the medication has a lot to do with it. So just understand that this is a challenge that they're facing, but be there to give them as much support as you possibly can. But most of all, pray and ask the Lord to lead and guide you and take care of you, because He will cover you, and your faith is the most important thing.
He is a healer. And he's a comforter.
He is a comforter.
Yes. He's a guide. So your advice to a mom that finds herself here, certainly is to pray and take the support of others.
Others, yes.
And I remember you saying you had to get out and do something for yourself.
Yes. I had a very close friend, Dr. Faye Barkley Shell, who told me one time, you leave, LaWanda is going to be fine with us. Mm-hmm. I didn't want to leave, but I took that advice, coming from the medical field. Mm-hmm. I had to.
Mm-hmm. Because, for your sake,
yes,
for your own health.
Yes.
I have a friend, her name is Donna Atkins, and she was diagnosed with breast cancer at 22. Mm-hmm. And we are all 49 now, and so that was 27 years ago. And I wanted her to be here and to be a part of this show, because a part of her testimony was that she did have to have the mastectomy. Mm-hmm. And she just, at first time married, a month ago? And so just the testimony of not only a mature woman waiting to be married, but also sometimes I believe when we've had these type of sicknesses and diagnoses, as women, we already struggle with identity and these insecurities that we have. And then to think, well, who would want me, or will I ever be married? And then for her testimony was, to me, such a wonderful climax and truth after 27 years of victory and survival, that God could put a seal on it and send a wonderful man of God into her life. And they've been happily married now for almost 2 months. So we say 20 years, 30 years, 40 years. And so I thank each of you for your story. I thank you for being here. I thank you for sharing. And I pray that something that someone has heard from any of these young ladies and our mature testimony from Mother Henry will encourage someone that there is life with the diagnosis and after the diagnosis. And God has not left the throne. He knows what you are going through, and He will be there to walk with you, to talk with you, and to carry you through. There is a place called through, and you're going to get to it. God bless you. We will be right back for Dr. Tuesday's Tidbits. It's a little segment where we like to tell you a little something about how to live life on purpose from God's perspective. We'll be right back. Life. Life can throw us many curves. We find ourselves one day living life on purpose, moving forward, and then all of a sudden we get a call, we get a report, we get news, we're told we need to come into the doctor's office. We get a call regarding our job or our company closing. We get a pink slip. Something happens. We get a call about a family member that's not well or has been in an accident. Life. Life happens. And we find ourselves asking God the question of why. Why me? Why now? I want to encourage you today. Jesus asked God why. Did you know that? He asked him why in the garden. Lord, why have you forsaken me? Why? Where are you in this moment? And what's curious about this statement with Jesus, Jesus knew he was going to the cross. He knew he had to go through the garden. He knew he had to go through this process. But even as we ended the last segment, there is a place called through, and you will get through this, just like Jesus did. Everything you go through has a purpose. When Jesus was with the woman at the well, and he said, I must need go through Samaria. There's a must need go through. We all have something we have to go through. And going through that is what will bring you closer to God. Rachel said it. Chastity said it. Mother Henry said it. It will bring you closer to God if you let your faith work. Now, you got to let your faith work. You got to let your faith work. You got to lean on and lean in to God. Seek him. Take him at his word. See what he has to say. I contend that, yes, these diagnoses and these things come and they hit our lives, but we can trust God. We can trust him that he will bring us through. Everyone's through may not be the same. Chastity and Rachel had two of the same diagnoses, the lymphoma, but it handled and hit them differently, but they still held on to their faith. And look at them today. Mother Henry's testimony is a little different. LaWanda went on to glory, but her faith is that she's going to see her daughter again. Have faith in God and do what they told you to do and live. Christ came that you might have life and have it abundantly. Many of us have life, but we're not living. God needs for you to live and to live on purpose. I challenge you today. Find your place called through and live life on purpose and watch God restore you back to health, restore you back to once was. I encourage you and I thank you. Thank you for joining us for Tuesdays with Tuesday. And we'll see you next time for a Dr. Tuesday tidbit. This is a Dr. Tuesday special. Have a great day.